themselves. Here's the ASCO CAP guidelines. These claimed that 20% of the testing in the field was incorrect for HER2. I always like to ask the question, what do you think is clinically more egregious, a false negative or a false positive? When I asked this question 10 years ago, when the drug was first being approved and the cardiac toxicity data was emerging, a vast majority of the audience said false positive. But now, after the adjuvant data, which we now know well, is showing such dramatic efficacy for targeting HER2 in the adjuvant setting, I strongly believe that false negative is more egregious. For the cardiotoxicity, we have medical oncologists, as I know, much more skilled in dealing with cardiotoxicity. They got their stethoscopes back around their necks and reviewed their internal medicine cardiology training, got advice from cardiology specialists, started doing things like avoid anthracyclines whenever possible. Maybe it's a platinum-trastuzumab combination is the way to do that. Number two, pick the patients at risk before they get treated. Are they hypertensive? Do they have diabetes? Have they had heart disease or congestive failure in the past? And then most recently, the therapy, ACE inhibitors and beta blockers, don't wait to give them when the ejection fraction falls. If you think the patient's at risk, give them before you start the trastuzumab. Get it on board for a week or 10 days. And then start the trastuzumab, and they seem to be graded chemo-preventing the trastuzumab cardiotox. So I think between avoiding anthracyclines early and late, and using the drugs in a chemo prevention, identifying higher risk patients, the chances of high level 3 and 4 cardiotoxicity for trastuzumab is dropping significantly. It's much closer to 1% now than 4%, and many more patients are able to complete courses of the drug, even a year, than there used to be. But gee, if I'm a newly diagnosed breast cancer patient, maybe at high risk, maybe I'm node positive, and my lab tells me I'm HER2 negative, when I'm really HER2 positive and I don't get trastuzumab in the adjuvant setting, what's happened to me? I've lost a 50% chance of avoiding relapse, maybe cure. So I think false negative has got to be reduced as close to zero as humanly possible. It's like a mission that I'm on, go around the country giving these testing talks saying, how can we prevent false negative HER2 results? How can we use the controls in the best possible way? How can we prepare the specimen in the cleanest and neatest way? Because there's evidence that 3 to 4% of breast cancers today are missed that are HER2 positive. And if you look at the IHC regimen with zeros and ones being negative and it having 80% of the market, we're talking about 3,000 to 4,000 women a year. And if that's the case, we could have 1,000 to 2,000 women a year relapsing unnecessarily with a breast cancer we should have cured, if we'd only had known and given them the right drugs. So that's that. One of the things for the IHC people who do IHC, always make sure, and I don't do this, this is just a schematic, it's not a real slide, make sure they put a 3+ positive control on the same slide as the unknown patient. This patient's HER2 negative on IHC here, and here's the 3+ showing 3+ staining in this area. If you don't put the same positive control on the same slide, you're not controlling for a reagent failure or a machine failure or some technical error. And a lot of commercial labs will run 50 of these a day, and the 50th slide's the control, the first 49 of the patients, the antibody dispenser didn't open and a drop of the antibody didn't drop on the slide. Since there's no built-in internal control, there's no background HER2 level in normal breast cells, you miss the fact that the patient never had a chance to be HER2 positive. And you don't see that so much in fish, because fish is, fish has its own built-in control where if you have a negative area like we do here, you can still see the positive signals for both the chromosome 17 in green and the HER2 in red. So we have built-in internal control for fish. Here's an example of where we can screw up in fish. Where CISH might be better is DCIS. Here's a DCIS HER2 positive. See the clusters of red signals, the positive gene copy number? Here's the invasive cancer around the edges here, separately looked at, and it's not amplified. We could spend the rest of the day trying to explain why could you get HER2 positive DCIS and then invade as HER2 negative. And there's no great explanation for this. People have said, oh, well, it has one role for development and another role for progression. It may be needed for development of a case and then not needed for progression. Hard to explain this, but it happens. And labs will sometimes mistakenly score this area, call it positive, and then the patient gets a metastasis biopsy a year or two later, it's negative, and they said, aha, it switched from positive to negative. Well, actually, it was never positive. Don't score DCIS. That we're trained to do. And now here's CISH. I mean, this test is a breeze. Why it hasn't taken off? Well, because Ventana didn't get an approval and Invitrogen did. But instead of marketing this ish, it bought Applied Bio, you know, TacMan, for $6 billion, and this whole company is completely consumed with absorbing this huge acquisition, and nobody's out there trying to sell this FDA-approved alternative to fish or IHC. What's advantages is that instead of using a fluorescent signal, it uses immunoperoxidase reagents, dimenobenzidine, and you can see two positive positive genes in each cell in this negative area, and robust clustered amplification in this HER2-positive case. These are so easy to score. I did a trial with one of my pathologists in which she scored 100 cases under the microscope, and I did it only by picking up the slide out of the box and putting it against my white lab coat. If it was gray, I said it was negative. If it was brown, I said it was positive. We had 87% concordance. I got every positive, I got every negative, and we just disagreed around the cutoff. It's a robust and easy to do test. The cost is going to be a lot lower than fish. More than IHC, but a lot lower than fish. And any laboratory that can do IHC can do this, and then they don't have to triage the fish to another lab. Patients all get their diagnosis at the same time. But right now, it's got zero, almost no market share. Whether or not Roche will push it after the Ventana one gets approved remains to be seen. Good. And here's that concordance data that Jim asked about, 98% fish versus cish. So the question becomes, what about novel ways?